Yo, internets, we're back with the Combat Jack Show. We got the legendary Willie D in the building, Houston. Stand up. No, Houston. Houston. Like, listen, like, out of all the regions that fuck with the Combat Jack Show, man, Houston really gives us support, man. And I really appreciate that, man. So, Houston, I mean it from my heart, man. We got a Houston. We got an original OG Houston representative in the building, man. Stand up. Willie, how you feeling, man?
I feel blessed, man.
We're not getting too deep, are we?
Huh? I don't think I've ever been asked that question.
Yo, let's go back to your early days, man, with regard to your career, man. Like, what made you want to rap?
I was in the neighborhood. We used to hang out.
Doing what, man?
Well, we used to hang out in the neighborhood, just like way back in the old days when you see these movies and they show these little doo-wop segments in the movie where the guys are hanging out and they're singing and stuff
like that. Like the doo-wop?
Yeah, we were hanging out one night and we were listening to music.
Like, what was y'all listening to, man?
We were listening to Run DMC, Suck MC.
Right. Revolutionary and, record, right?
Yeah, man.
Revolutionary record.
And one of my buddies, Steve Mayweather, said, man, me and Willie can do that. Mm. I was 16.
Why did he think you could do that?
I don't know, man. I mean, he just threw me under the bus, really, because I had no aspirations to rap.
Right.
Never even thought about it.
Right.
I was going to be a fighter. I was going to be a boxer.
Right.
Or I was going to go and become an airline pilot for military or something.
Right, right. You wanted to go to the military, man?
Yeah.
Okay. Because you were a fighter.
It's going to be a pilot.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's going to be like, I wanted to be like a combat pilot for in the military or something, you know? And Steve was like, me and Willie can do that. And I was like, and everybody was like, yeah, right. Yeah. And so I'm listening, and I'm listening to the rhyme scheme.
What was your favorite, man, Runner or DMC?
DMC.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm listening to the rhyme scheme, and I'm like, it sounds pretty simple, you know? I think I might be able to do that. So he goes in his house, I go in my house, and we come out in 1 hour. He does his rap, everybody start laughing. I do mine, and they start raising eyebrows.
What was your first rap, man?
I don't even remember.
You remember your first rap, Willie?
I can't remember.
Right.
Whatever it was, I mean, I couldn't fuck with Run DMC.
Right, right.
Whatever it was, it was good enough to know to make them raise their eyebrows.
Right. You sensed that power.
Yeah. When they did that, I was like,
oh shit.
Maybe it's something, you know?
Right.
So, I wrote. I think that night I wrote about 8 bars mm-hmm. in an hour.
Right.
So after that, I wrote another 8 bars, so I got a 16.
You got 16.
And then
you got a mean 16.
Then I wrote another 16.
So you got 2 16s in your pocket right now.
And the first 16 I wrote, I would go around rapping that 16, and anytime somebody tried to battle me, I would rap that 16, and when I get to the end, I'd be like, you know what, man, I ain't gonna even go no more, you fool. You know what I'm saying? I'm wasting my time.
Right, right.
And everybody, woo! But I ain't had no more raps. You know what I'm saying?
You ran out.
Yeah, I ran out. So I didn't have anything else to say.
Right. So how did it get from doing these raps with your friends to like being a professional thing? Like, how did you run into the legendary J Prince, man?
What it was is that the way it progressed is that I wrote a 16, then I wrote another 16, now I got a whole song.
Right. And did you know about writing songs? Because most motherfuckers just write.
No, I wrote
before they learn how to write a song.
I basically was mimicking the structure of some of the other artists.
Right, right.
I was like, okay, they're doing this many. Like, at that time, we called them lines, not bars.
So you were really studying the song.
Yeah.
Writing process, which is amazing.
Yeah, and I was studying LL Cool J too. Because what I liked about LL Cool J was his use of words.
He had a great vocabulary.
He had an extensive vocabulary. He didn't just use, like those predictable words.
Right.
And I liked the idea that sometimes, oftentimes, you didn't know how he was going to end the rap.
Right.
How he was going to end the rhyme part. So I don't like people finishing my rhyme. Don't say my fucking rhyme before I say it.
Right. Don't figure that shit out.
Exactly. So, I try not to write that type of rap where somebody can finish any one of my lines.
Right, right.
So that's the way I started writing. And then I started battling. And the first time I battled, I went to this place called Flashes.
Nightclub.
And I went up against Romeo Poet and the Raw Flush. At that point, Romeo Poet was a solo artist, and then he teamed up with the Raw Flush. These two dudes were like the coldest cats in the city when it came to battling.
They had it on lock.
Yeah, they had it on lock. So I went on.
Were you nervous when you went?
Unbeknownst to me.
Right.
Man, I was nervous. I didn't even know what it was. I was too stupid to be nervous. I was crazy, man. I didn't care. You know, I was went up on stage. Now they was beatboxing. They had the mute. They had an actual beatboxer. They had a DJ.
They had the beatbox machine.
They had the DJ. They had three rappers.
Did they have the echo chamber?
I don't know about all that.
Right.
But they had. They were a crew.
They were well oiled,
and they rocked the house, like rocked it. And here I go. I get on stage. I don't even have music. I'm getting on stage and I rap a cappella.
Right.
Boo, get the fuck off stage. Get your ass off stage. Boo, boo, boo. So I cussed the crowd out.
that's numero uno, man. You don't cuss the crowd.
Man, I cussed the crowd
fuck
out.
Fuck you.
I cussed the crowd out. And I was like, yeah, I'll be back.
Okay.
You know, so 1 week later, I came back.
Was you tight when you went home? Because how does it feel to get booed, man?
Felt pretty bad. Right. But again, like I said, I'm vengeful.
Right.
So I wanted to get them back.
Right.
I wanted to get the crowd back.
So you wrote specific rhymes for these cats.
So I went back and I was like, I had to step my game up. So right. I studied what they did. I said, okay, so first of all, I got to give me some music.
Right.
So I got some music and I came back the next week and I did a rap again. This time, I didn't win, but I didn't get booed either.
Right.
So
was it? What was it? Was it? They won.
They won. They won the next like maybe. I had to go against them maybe, I think 6-7 times before I finally won.
Wasn't nobody tapping you on the shoulder like, "Yo, son, stay home, man. Leave them dudes alone."
Nah, I wouldn't have listened anyway because I thought that I was closing in on them.
Yeah, you knew
every week. Every week I felt like I was getting a little closer, you know? And I knew it was getting a little closer when they would come up and shake my hand.
Right. That was kind of
dope. And then I said, what you gonna say? And stuff like that. They felt me coming.
Who was this motherfucker? And was your name Willie D from
there? Yeah.
Okay, you never had no...
Willie D came, I got the name Willie D in the 10th grade.
Right.
My best friend, Ronald Hopes, he was like, man, they got Billy D and we got Willie D. And it stuck.
So you named after Billy D. Williams, man.
Well, nah, I was inspired by.
I'm inspired by Billy D.
Yeah.
Drinking that Colt 45.
Yeah. So I started battling,
right.
And after about the sixth, seventh time, I finally won. And then
how did that feel?
It felt real good. I mean, I felt like I had climbed the mountaintop.
Right. What was their response?
They were dejected because they was the kings.
Yo, you dethroned the kings.
They were dejected. But after a while, you know, we started battling at this place called Rhinestone. And Rhinestone is the most famous club in Houston of all time.
Right.
That was the spot that you battled. The battle raps was be on Sunday nights. Mm-hmm. And it went till, the club would close at 4 a.m. And you start battling at like, the battle rap part would push and would start around 2:30.
Right.
Every morning.
All right.
People would miss work, be late for work to watch the battle rap. Dudes would come from New York to battle. They was just coming for me and anybody that was there because they heard about this rap contest in Houston.
Right. What was the prize, man?
It was corny, man. It was like $100 or something, and then didn't even get all the money ever.
They took tax out, man?
Dude named Big Steve, man.
Big Steve tax you money?
That nigga still owe me a few dollars, man.
Gave you like $87?
Yeah. But we was just so... But my thing was that we was just... See, back then, it was a pride thing.
Right.
The money was cool.
Of course, we didn't do it for the money.
The money was cool, but wanted the pride more than... It was about pride more than anything.
Right.
Like, I'm the top dog.
Right.
Can't nobody beat me. And once we got over to the Rhinestone, I kind of basically took over.
Right.
And
so you was winning consistently.
I was winning consistently and mostly.
Right.
And then the last 13 weeks it was open, I won every week in a row.
13 in a row.
13 in a row. Even Vanilla Ice came out there four weeks. He came out there and I smashed him.
He was
the thing that I liked about Vanilla Ice is that he was courageous.
Right.
The dude was fearless. Like, he would get up on the stage and he'd rap, and that was the, it was a two-part.
Was he the only white boy in the joint?
It was two, most of the time. Right. It was a two-part a series for the contest. The first part was you do a regular rap, and then if you made it to the second round, you know, that's the battle rap part.
Right.
And so people would automatically cheer for him so they can get him in the battle rap part. So he could tat that ass up. Yeah. So that's how he ended up in the battle rap part every time. And I remember he used to rap and he would be up, like he had a mic and he'd be like all in my face, like,
you know, like, oh, word?
Yeah, he'd just be
just
doing
came
that.
At you.
Yeah, like he was serious.
He was
like,
serious.
Yeah. But
that's a good story.
I respected that though.
Did you respect when he blew up after this?
Yeah, I actually told Jay to sign him.
Really?
I told Jay to sign him. Actually, I watched his demo tape. It was on a VHS.
Right.
And you know, this is something you can't make up.
Of course,
right?
Of course.
So I'm in Jay's office, and he asked me what I think. I say, man, he can't really rap that good.
Right. But he's heartless.
But no, I said he can't really rap that good. His rap it's okay.
Right.
But he can dance and he white. I sign him.
Why didn't Jay sign him, man?
Jay later said that he wanted to sign him, but he had left it up to his partner, Cliff.
Right.
Cliff Blodgett was his partner at the time, and he thought that Cliff had signed him. And he said that I recently heard him say in an interview that when he heard the music on the radio, he was like, ooh, we got a hit, you know.
he
called Cliff, and Cliff said, nah, man, I didn't.